So let's call the meeting to order.
Okay.
Hadley Board of Health, and present is Margaret Mastrangelo, Peter Lorre, our administrative assistant, myself, Susan Mosler. Greg Misch is still out on medical leave. We are hoping that he will be able to rejoin us sometime over the next month. And we miss him. And we certainly miss the skill set that he brings to the Board of Health.
You're here.
So we can, has anybody, Margaret, have you had a chance to review the minutes?
Oh, yes. So, in fact, I was going to ask if we were going to vote to accept them.
Yes, but I need a motion.
Okay, I have a motion then to accept the minutes from January 13th.
Okay, I second that. Let's have a vote. Margaret?
Yes.
Yes. Mosler, yes. Okay, the minutes are accepted. I do not have the agenda in front of me. Margaret, what's the next?
Review and vote on businesses up for permit renewals.
Okay, Peter.
Yeah, I'll take that one. So this evening we have several food establishments that have applied to renew their permits for 2020. We also have some hotels and motels who have applied to renew their hotel and motel permits, as well as their swimming pool permits. So I'll go ahead and read the establishments, and then you guys can vote once I'm done reading them. So in terms of food establishments, where food is served in some fashion, the list includes Old Navy, Cinemark, Courtyard by Marriott, Howard Johnson, Comfort Inn, Econolodge, Tandem Bagel, and the Lane Center at Hadley. In terms of pool permits, it's Homewood Suites, Hampton Inn, Econolodge, Comfort Inn, Howard Johnson, and Courtyard by Marriott. And hotel permits, the applicants include Courtyard by Marriott, Hampton Inn, Homewood Suites, Econolodge, and Comfort Inn. All these people have, again, sent in their applications as well as paid the associated fee. So they're all in good standing and so forth as far as the application process is concerned. So in terms of you know, accepting their applications and approving them, I'll leave that up to you guys.
Hey, Margaret, you want to make a motion?
I will make a motion that we accept the businesses that are asking for permit renewals.
Okay, I second the motion to issue the permits. Let's have a vote. Margaret?
Mastrangelo, yes.
Mosler, yes. Okay, so...
Just one footnote, Susan, if anybody's on the call from any of these establishments, the intent is to email all the permits out to you tomorrow when I get back into the office.
Okay. Peter, I also want to formally acknowledge all of your hard work and thank you for it.
Thank you. You're welcome.
Okay. Next on the agenda, Margaret?
I'm going to skip number four until Nicole can come with us. She'll be here at past seven. Rapid testing update. I had dropped several boxes of rapid test kits off to the senior center a couple of days ago. I did ask that Alicia let us know how we stand with the use of those. I have not heard from her, and I'm not sure when I checked, and I checked the Board of Health email late today that we did hear back. Peter, do you mind?
I'll reach out to her and see how many kits we have there. And, you know, we want to try to stay a week or two ahead of the demand. So I'll let you know if we need to order them. The expiration dates on them are like 6 months out. So we don't really have to worry about the kit's expiring. So I will check with Alicia. Thank you for your work on that. And I'm really pleased that we have free available testing here in Hadley to anybody basically who wants to get COVID tested. So, okay.
Okay, that's good. Well, I'm kind of skipping around here. So I'm going to do an update on Title V issues. And basically, that had to do with, Peter, I did bring back into the office the stuff that I had reviewed with Richard Wilga that I think just needs filing. There was one piece of paper that Richard said really he thought DPW would handle. I can't remember. That was a little while ago when I looked at it last. Must have had something to do with the sewer lines. So I put that in their pigeon slot. So I don't know. In case you do hear anything, it's probably about that. And then, you know, the rest of the paperwork just seemed like it needed filing. I know we're gearing up. We're coming into that season in another couple of months. And we'll see what happens with the Title V stuff otherwise. Any new things that came across?
Yeah, actually, Margaret, there was, I received a Title V upgrade application today while I was in the office, actually, while I was in the office this morning, and a check was received and so forth. So, the game plan is for me to reach out to Greg tomorrow.
Absolutely.
Through Leslie, obviously, and see if I can drop that off for him to review. I don't know how time sensitive this particular application is, but I don't want it to sit too long. So my game plan is to hopefully get it to him tomorrow, let him review it, do whatever he has to do, and then we go from there.
Terrific.
But yeah, but there's only one pending.
Okay. That's great.
Yeah.
Okay.
I did, when I spoke with Greg this week, I asked him if he had been checking his emails and he said no, but he said that he would start doing so. So
great.
I'll send him a test tomorrow and see if he's
okay. Also, I did speak with Alan.
Yes, from the.
Alan Weiss.
And you know, I told him the situation we were in. He was totally fine with it. He said that he in the past had worked directly with Greg anyway, and so he knows. He said, I know Greg from way back. He said, if you have any issues, I'll reach out to him directly, and if that doesn't work, he will circle back to us.
Good.
Well, he was, you know.
Yeah, they have a long time working relationship. So
yeah. So that was good. Let's talk about the next item, update on the CAP and water testing.
Yes.
I'm just trying to gather my thoughts on this now.
We were asking for an extension of the fund.
Right. So I met with the Community Preservation Commission, CPC. And on Monday night via Zoom, and they did agree to extending for one more year only the funds, which I think came to like $1,240, something like that. everyone agreed to it except one, because the issue was it was a stretch to use this money for the testing. And then they also understood the very unusual circumstances related to testing given COVID. But they're willing to extend it for another year, but really that in the future should be rolled into our own budget, because they do not do, they don't fund things that otherwise would be part of normal operating expenses. So, the last communication I had with Jason was I was trying to get a sense from him how much he would be using, what is being tested, and he really wanted to meet instead have a kind of a group meeting with DPW and the town administrator, et cetera. And, you know, that's just at this point in time is going to have to be pushed back. There are too many irons in the fire that I know that town administration is dealing with. And, you know, that is, not going to rise to the top. So that's the update anyway on that. And I see that Nicole has joined us. So without further ado, Nicole, thank you so much for joining us tonight. I'd like to introduce you to the committee, Susan Mosler.
Hi, Nicole, thank you so much.
And Peter Laurie, our incredibly gifted and competent admin assistant here.
She really said incompetent.
Hardly. But anyway, we're really grateful for you coming because, as you know, the town has no inspector. So pretty much, we are not meeting the needs we should be meeting in terms of being in compliance with local and national guidelines. We have
other than just guidelines, you know, regulations and the whole nine requirements. So,
Nicole, maybe could you just tell us your experience and what you bring to the table here before we have this conversation?
Sure, absolutely. So I want to say recently became a member of the town of Hadley as a resident about a year ago now. Prior to that, I lived in the town of Shutesbury for 20 years. But my history and my experience in public health is I have 15 years of local public health experience. I am the former director for the city of Greenfield, where I held that position for 10 years and was an inspector for 5 years. Wow. So I spent a lot of years in local public health. I left the director position in Greenfield in 2017, and I left that position to run my family business. So I'm a local business owner and run a family, third generation owners of a family business with my husband. And so that is my full-time gig at the moment. For a while after I left Greenfield, I spent the next three and a half years still in local public health. I did keep my foot in the door for a while after I left the full-time position, doing consulting, doing inspections, helping out various towns, including Greenfield. I worked for the FERCOG part-time as a health agent. I consulted for Northampton, for East Hampton, and I officially left public health in the fall of 2019. So really,
just
right
before. Fine.
I like to say I dodged the biggest public health bullet of my career. And not to say that I couldn't get back into it, because I will say I probably got at least a half a dozen job offers to come back during COVID from various communities, including Greenfield, to consult and help, get some communities through COVID. And actually, I did come back very temporarily for the city of East Hampton, and I worked and assisted their health director, who was my former inspector in Greenfield. She basically begged me, and I did go and help her out for about 5 months, and did assist her a little bit through the pandemic in the beginning stages. And quite honestly, really, my business is commercial HVAC, and we just became extremely busy with our accounts for COVID. And, commercial HVACs, we do a lot with schools. And so you can imagine the ventilation issues that we began to deal with when COVID arised. And so that has just really taken over. I'm going to say I work more than full time. So, yes. Very busy with the business end of things.
Thank you for sharing that. You clearly bring a lot to the table. And again, we are so appreciative. I'm sure Margaret, shared some information with you. Basically, we have our three members of the Board of Health who are elected mm-hmm. officials. And we have Peter, who's on this call, who's our administrative assistant. We have him for 7 hours a week.
Mm-hmm.
And we have a public health nurse for approximately 7 hours a week who's yep. doing our COVID testing and the like. Yep. So, sorry about that. Hold on.
Sounds like the bat phone.
I don't even know how to use that phone. I apologize. Anyway, we are trying to, first of all, delineate all of the tasks that would be done by an employee of the mm-hmm. Board of Health, a town employee. We're trying to identify the tasks and the scope of work hours that would be required to meet the responsibilities of the Board of Health in the town, mm-hmm. According to the state of Massachusetts and state and federal laws.
Yep.
We have a sense of some numbers,
yep.
but we are really looking for some concrete way to quantify what the needs are as far as an employee, what the needs are for the town to accomplish the work. I was wanting to know if I just read out some things that we had that need to be done, that we know need to be done.
Mm-hmm.
And I guess we're kind of wondering if you could help us quantify some of those things.
I mean, sure. I mean, I'm definitely happy to answer any questions. There's a really, and I'd have to find it. It is located on the MassDPH website, and I know that I probably have it in my old documents, which I still have access to on my home computer. But it's a document that was put together probably about 5 or 6 years ago by DPH and. I forget like the official name of it, but it's a very useful document when it comes to laying out all of the responsibilities of a local Board of Health, a local health department. It's about, 5 or 6 pages. It lists out all of the regulations and all of the duties that could possibly fall under a local Board of Health. Is that something that you guys have any familiarity with? Have you seen it? Do you know what's in it? Have you, because that is a really good starting point.
So
I think we do have something similar to that. I think, mm-hmm. I think, Nicole, we have a sense of the scope of the work
yep.
that needs to get done. But our question, what we're trying to figure out is, in other words, we know we need to do 250 food inspections a year, mm-hmm. initial inspections.
Yep.
And then after those inspections are done, we found that almost 80% had a foodborne violation.
Mm-hmm.
So all of those need to be followed up and due process done for that.
Yeah. And so you have your initial inspection and then your re-inspection. Yep.
Right. And then, if something has to be written up and they have to be brought for a hearing from the Board of Health. But
mm-hmm.
so what we're trying to get a sense of is how do we quantitate how many hours a week that might take up?
Mm-hmm. Yep. I think one of the first things you should do if you haven't done it already is put together some kind of chart where you are listing out all of your permits. So, all of your permits that you issue on a yearly basis.
We have that.
Okay, so perfect. That's a good part to start at. And then from there, you can sort of list out the different types of establishments and essentially what an initial, like a timeline of an initial inspection. So like you have, like say you have your grocery markets versus your restaurants versus your, you know, convenience store. Obviously an inspection of a grocery market is going to take way longer than an inspection of your convenience
store. How long does it take? Give us a guesstimate.
A grocery store inspection, a thorough one, you're going to be there for anywhere from 4 to 6 hours. It's basically a half to a three quarter day inspection.
Margaret, can you take some
notes? Yeah, I'm doing that now.
I mean, if you're really getting into a thorough inspection and doing it the way that it should be done, you're taking temperatures, you are opening every single refrigerator door. You know, you're getting into the nitty gritty.
We want to hear what it takes to do due diligence. So you're saying 4 to 6 hours for a grocery store. And how about for a restaurant?
For a restaurant, anywhere, about an hour to an hour and a half.
And what other food type vendors do we have, Margaret? We have convenience stores.
Well, so we have it broken down into mega stores, mega and large. So that includes the grocery stores such as Aldi's, Big Y, mm-hmm. Whole Foods, Trader Joe's, Target, Walmart, and Stop and Shop. Mm-hmm. So that's that group. And then we have the larger restaurants. So like mm-hmm. Texas Roadhouse,
Applebee's,
Chili's, mm-hmm. that sort of thing.
How long do those size restaurants take, Nicole?
Those size restaurants, anywhere probably from an hour to an hour and a half. Okay. Obviously, if you get into a restaurant that has not been doing what they should be doing, could be there a lot longer. If inspections haven't been taken place in a year plus, you know, could be longer that first round out. If you're behind on inspections, to get everyone caught back up, that type of deal.
So let me fill you in. We have, you know, Western Mass Food Safety has been doing our inspections, but they mm-hmm. do the inspections and then that's it. There's nothing done with that. So unfortunately, there have been some repeat offenders, consistently mm-hmm. repeated offenders, who have sort of egregious foodborne violations.
So, Nicole, what would the process be for a restaurant, say, that has, you know, two flagged foodborne illness violations?
Sure. So, I mean, you have your initial inspection.
Right.
The inspector completes the inspection. They do the write-up of the report. They review that with the manager on site. Depending what those violations are, because, you know, the violations are sort of marked out as, you know, high, moderate, low, depending on the risk category that they fall into.
We're talking about high, the serious ones.
So the serious ones, I mean, you give 24 hours for correction. In some instances, I would be on site in a restaurant and say, you need to correct this right now while I'm here on site. Or I would say, I will be back tomorrow morning at when you open. This needs to be corrected by then. If not, you'll be facing, you know, whatever consequences that high violation would warrant. In most cases, high violations warrant a shutdown if they're not corrected immediately.
So if you go in and, you know, you see the major violation, you tell them they have 24 hours mm-hmm. and then you go back 24 hours later and it hasn't been taken care of. Tell us what happens then.
So depending what the actual violation is, they'd either be shut down right there on the spot, or they would have an emergency hearing in front of the Board of Health. So it would really depend a lot on how you guys as the Board of Health would want to dictate in terms of the leeway. Right. I don't like to use the word power. That's not a term that I've ever really liked to use right. in this job, but the leeway you would give the inspector in terms right. of how far you would let them go in compliance and decision-making with that restaurant. Are you going to allow that inspector to make the decision to shut down that restaurant? Or are you as a Board of Health going to say to that inspector, we don't want you to make that decision. We as a Board of Health want to make that decision. You'll need to call an emergency hearing and, right. and come to us for that decision. So right. it really depends how you guys want the flow to happen.
Right. I think my sense is, Margaret, how many, I know we have 250 inspections, but we don't have 250 food vendors. What did we say we have?
So I looked at the data that we had been given, which wasn't all the places, we had 94 food establishments that were inspected between January and November of last year. Mm-hmm. Some received only one visit, some two visits, and some three visits, depending upon.
But overall, we think that we have what, about 130 or 140?
Yeah, about 130.
So Nicole, how do we, if we want to write up a proposal for a mm-hmm. job description, and we want to have some details on and ways to back up how many hours we need. I mean, how do we figure out how many hours just food inspections would take, knowing that we have like 130 food vendors?
Yeah, I mean, you're going to have to, what you would need to do is you need to take your list of all your permitted food vendors, categorize them how Margaret was saying. You've got your super, your large, your medium, you've got your gas station convenience stores, you've got your churches.
Right.
I don't know if that includes your temporary food vendors, because I know a lot's going on in the summer with
no.
Events.
We figured about 50 for that.
Okay, so you throw them in the categories, and then that's when you would apply the hours to them in terms of initial inspection, and then you could apply hours to them in terms of if they required a reinspection. Now, here's the deal with reinspections. Now, the big guys, the grocery stores, the high volume restaurants, there's always violations. There's never not violations. Any inspector that goes in and says, oh, I found no violations at Texas Roadhouse. Of course you did. It right. all depends on to what level you find right. these violations at and if they warrant a reinspection.
Right.
In most cases, a high volume restaurant is going to have a list of violations, and they may not all be, none of them may be high priority violations, it's going to require reinspection.
Right. We understand that because, Meredith O'Leary, mm-hmm. has kind of clued us in. In other words, when they do the inspections, they let us know. And, we were told if there was more than two of these major serious foodborne risks, violations, yeah. those are the ones that needed
reinspection. Yeah.
And to be honest, we've had quite a few of them.
Yeah. So very rarely are you going to have like a high volume or a large grocery store that's not going to need a reinspection. So you can easily apply, an hour for a reinspection for those ones. A church kitchen, you're not going to need a reinspection likely for a church kitchen. A convenience store, more than likely not going to need a reinspection for those.
Restaurants often do need a reinspection.
Absolutely. Yeah. Most of the time they do. Very rarely does a restaurant not need a reinspection.
All right. So for a reinspection, would you say an hour?
Well, leaving the office, getting in the car, driving there, getting into the restaurant, performing the actual reinspection.
So it's more like 2 hours.
Well, it depends. It depends where the inspector is located, where the drive time is, getting the paperwork complete, talking with the manager on staff, leaving that inspection, either going to the next inspection or going back to the office.
So Peter and Margaret, do you get a sense now of that we might be able to calculate more closely the number of hours we might need per year?
Well, certainly with the grocery stores and some of the reinspections, yes.
And the restaurants.
So the grocery stores, these mega ones, are gonna require half a day. We were only saying about an hour. So, we didn't know. We're just trying to put our best guess into it. And also, we understand that it's not just something that you write out a list of violations. It may be that you've got to do a correction plan with them. So that's going to require time on your part to sit down and write right. out, okay, what is this plan of correction? And so what we're trying to be able to do is, okay, with 130 food establishments, of which, you know, three are mega grocery stores, five are large stores, three large concessions, 20 large restaurants, how we kind of go about that in terms of setting it up. Like, how many hours, you know, would that take? Mm-hmm. You know, given that you've also got to sit down and maybe write out these correction plans. And that's the part that gets fuzzy and gray mm-hmm. for us. It's one thing to say it'll take an hour to do an inspection. It's another, because we don't do the behind the scenes work to try
What is the behind the scenes work, Nicole, would you say?
So, I mean, you like Margaret was saying, obviously you have the inspection process when you're in the facility, you are, you know, going through everything that the facility has and finding, you know, violations or not. You know, obviously the goal is hopefully they're doing a good job and staying up on, you know, what they're supposed to be. But so that's the actual physical inspection part. And then from there, inspectors handle the behind the scenes part. We see it done a couple different ways. Some inspectors will remain on site and they will, like, I'll use a restaurant, for example, they'll take a seat at a booth and they will write out the inspection report, or if they're doing it on a tablet, if it's electronic, they will sit at a booth and they will complete the inspection report on site. And then once the inspection report is completed, they will ask the manager on duty or whoever the manager on site is to join them, and they will review that inspection report. Sometimes they will sit at the booth together and they will review line by line the violations that the facility is being cited for. Other times they'll get up and they will walk through the facility and the inspector will go through the violations with the manager on site. They'll do that if the manager does not join them during the initial inspection. So it depends, because sometimes you get into a facility and the manager will say, just go do your thing, I'm too busy to join you. And the inspector's kind of left to their own accord and will complete the inspection on their own.
So
other times a manager will join the inspector through the course of the entire inspection.
So
and
he's
sitting there taking notes.
Do you think we need to add another hour on to each of these inspections to consider?
I would say anywhere from 30 minutes to an hour. And
okay.
And that's where it gets hard to predict, because you could have a restaurant that's doing a really great job that takes a lot of pride,
right.
And you could have a restaurant that is just a total disaster and a mess. So that's where you kind of, you have to find an average.
Right.
I usually say anywhere from 30 minutes to an hour, you could be behind the scenes. The other way that we have seen inspectors perform the behind the scenes work is they don't want to stay on site and do the inspection report. Some inspectors, what they will do is they will schedule their day. They will schedule, you know, three or four inspections back to back for the day. And then they will go back to the office. They will
right.
complete the paperwork either later that day or the next day. And then they will return to the site and review the inspection report with the manager that way. So inspectors sort of have their own kind of way how they want to function and perform, you know, the related duties.
Okay, great.
So.
Peter?
Yeah, but Nicole,
are you getting more of a sense here of that we might be able to actually calculate out some reasonable hours required?
Well, again, I, you know, based upon what Nicole has said, if I understand it correctly, you know, a large grocery store, like a, again, pick any of them, Stop and Shop, could take 4 to 6 hours. Sounds like restaurants, 1 to 1.5 hours. And there's after, if you will, after visit work, or AVW, if you will. And then, so I've got two or three questions just to clarify. Nicole, when as a health inspector, would you traditionally do two visits per year?
100%.
As a standard, or is that a requirement? Or
so that's a requirement, and that is broken down in the food code. Certain establishments are required twice a year. Other establishments are required once a year. Like a church kitchen, that's a once a year inspection. A grocery store, a high volume restaurant, those are absolutely twice a year inspections.
What about a convenience store? So as an example, on Route 9, we've got a bajillion gasoline stations, or at least seems that way. Attached to every gas station, there's a convenience store.
Well, and here's the deal with the convenience stores. They now all prepare food. And
yeah, they do. They cook right there.
Okay. Right. So, and that's going to now put them in a moderate risk category. So they're now subject to two inspections a year. If you have a gas station that's just sort of doing all prepackaged, that isn't handling, you know, ready to eat food or preparing food on site, they're a once a year. The other thing that you can do as a Board of Health that you are allowed to do, you are allowed to take all of your food permitted establishments and you are allowed to go through them all and categorize them into high, moderate, and low risk facilities. And where you're saying, okay, this facility is absolutely high risk, you know, nursing home, they've got to be inspected at minimum. You as a Board of Health can dictate. You can say, we want them inspected four times a year. The minimum is two. But as a Board of Health, you have the authority to say, we want to see this nursing home and kitchen inspected four times a year instead of the two. I mean, that's going above, but you do have that authority. But we have seen a lot of Boards of Health, and we did do this in Greenfield. We did risk categorize our food establishments to determine, you know, how often we were going to be doing our inspections yearly with those facilities.
What about, you mentioned church kitchens, if you will. I think you said once a year.
Yeah. I mean, church kitchens are fairly low risk. They're not, you know, serving food on a daily basis most of the time.
Right.
You know, it's a weekend or an evening here or there. A lot of times they're opening up their kitchens to, you know, volunteers and youth and that kind of stuff. So, I mean, once a year, church kitchens always fell low risk for us.
How about schools, Nicole? We have three schools.
Yeah.
Yeah, so three schools in Hadley that are permitted.
Schools fall into a different
cafeterias.
Yeah, schools fall into a different category because schools receive federal funding for their lunches. They actually are required by those federal funds to be inspected twice a year. So they should have a fall and spring inspection regardless, just because of that reason.
Okay. You mentioned probably about 5 minutes ago, you know, the use of a tablet.
Mm-hmm.
You know, some towns don't do, at least from what I've seen thus far, a lot of towns don't leverage technology the way they could or the way they should. You know, hopefully we get to the point where, you know, we recruit this health inspector. He or she is somewhat tech savvy, if you will, and chooses to use a tablet not only to do the inspection, but then to upload, if you will, into a database. Mm-hmm. Is that, you know, from your experience, is that kind of the process that you're most familiar with? And does that make sense?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, if you can go digital, I say go digital. If you can get that food form on a tablet and they can perform those inspections on the tablet, you can upload, you can email it, you can just have everything, you know, way easier. Again, easier to just run reports, the whole nine.
Right.
So,
and the reason why I asked that question is, again, getting back to Susan's point about, if you will, after visit work or after inspection work, if you will, it seems to me that, again, if our inspector is utilizing, you know, some kind of tablet, and again, is able to, you know, fill in the blanks, if you will, or check the boxes, if you will, on the form digitally, save it, and then send it, Mm-hmm. Again, either to a database that the town has established, and or send a copy to whomever, the mm-hmm. establishment manager, establishment owner. To me, that saves a lot of time. Dealing with paper, filing the paper, making copies, mailing it out, blah blah blah. All that stuff. To me, that's just extra work. So I raise that only as a potential work saver or time saver. That again, I know our town is not necessarily 100% tech savvy. Let's just put it that way. Mm-hmm. Hopefully, Susan and Margaret, whoever we hire, is comfortable technology as a tool.
There's no question. There's no question of that. We would not hire somebody who was not. Nicole, can you tell us briefly what kind of training someone gets to be able to do the food part of this? Would have to do the food part of this job. How do you become? To do this?
That's an interesting question, because unfortunately the state of Massachusetts does not have any sort of quote unquote formal health inspector training.
And or
requirement.
Wow.
And it's been something that's been a real kind of it's just been a tough thing for many, many years. And one of the things that a lot of health departments, boards of health have been trying to establish for decades now is some sort of formal process for health officials, health inspectors, even boards of health as well, as far as like a certification process goes, things like that. One of the closest things, and towns and boards of health can set requirements on their own for hiring, and that's what ends up happening.
Right. So what would we be looking for?
So one of the absolute minimum things, and the food code requires this, is that your inspector be ServSafe certified.
Yeah, but that's nothing.
That's nothing. Correct. That's like an absolute minimum. Yeah. It's borderline nothing. And it's quite sad in the end. It's quite sad.
Yeah. That's not put in any way. Yeah.
Correct. A lot of towns require their inspector to be an RS, which is a registered sanitarian. That is a certification that the state of Massachusetts offers. And that is, you study, you take a test, you have to be, licensed with the state, you have to get recertified, you have to have continuing education.
RS is licensed by the state.
Correct. Yep.
How do you get an RS?
You have to meet the qualifications, that the state, outlines, in terms of, being able to, get the license, and then, again, you study for the exam and hopefully pass it. It's not an easy exam to pass.
How long
is this exam just for food, or does it cover septic and other Board of Health issues?
It does. It covers other Board of Health issues as well. And that's why it ends up being a big requirement when hiring for.
That would be important for us to have someone who is RS certified.
Correct. Yeah, I think so.
Particularly because we don't have a lot of experience in it ourselves.
Yep. A lot of towns will say RS or the ability to obtain that, or obtain within 1 year of employment, that kind of deal.
Nicole, how long does it take to obtain an RS? Well, is it a year's program? Is it a 6 month program?
To be quite honest, it's basically when they offer the test and studying.
It's not a class. Take the test.
Correct.
Okay. Yep. Got it.
Yep. Back before the pandemic, the state offered a course called Foundations of Local Public Health. Anytime I hired anyone in Greenfield to come work for me, I put every employee through this course. They may be offering it online right now. It's been a couple of years that I've kind of been out of the loop. But it was called the Foundations of Public Health. This was a 12 to 16 week course that basically covered everything in local public health. It was online. It was a mix of online and in-person classes. And, you know, by the time the person was done, they just were able to come out of that having a much broader range of understanding of local public health.
Also would have been positioned to study and take the RS exam.
Yeah, it would be absolutely helpful. Yep.
And what do these programs go for?
Well, the foundations course was no cost. I mean, there was no cost for that. Okay. And like I said, I mean, I put every employee through that course.
Wow.
The other thing is, and I can look up, and I'm just drawing a blank right now again, because it has been a couple of years, but there is an association in the state of Mass that has online courses, various online public health courses that, again, I would put any new employee through as well. I think they were called the Local Institute for Public Health, if my memory is serving me correctly. Local Institute for Public Health. Yes, that was it. If you Google that, it will take you to their website, and they offer online training for public health staff. And so that was very a very good resource for learning the ropes of local public health as well.
You kind of
have to get creative in the ways that you are training people in local public health, because there is just no formal process to it. Yeah. Yeah.
Can I ask a question? So far, we have really kind of concentrated the hours with food inspections. Mm-hmm. In your experience, do the food inspections take up majority of a health inspector's tasks? Is it pretty evenly divided between sanitary codes, you know, housing codes, or other types of inspections that you might do?
Yeah, I mean, and I'm not super familiar with Hadley, just because I haven't been in town for very long, so I don't know sort of the background, but I mean, I know that I'm on septic, so I can imagine when I think about
it. We have a lot of people on septic, and then starting in the spring,
yeah,
it gets quite busy.
Sure, absolutely. Everyone, that's, you know, start a perk season and, you know,
anybody
all of that.
Anybody that's selling a house or putting an addition in their house. Yeah.
Sure. No, I mean, definitely food. I mean, there's a lot going on with the food establishments and food permitting in Hadley. So I think that is certainly a good chunk of what an inspector would be doing in Hadley. But, you know, you've got septic. And if you've got, you know, do you know what percentage is, like 75% of the town on septic, 50% of the town?
I have a feeling it's very high.
Yeah.
I haven't told what it was. But I think, I want to say it could be up to about 70%. I feel that might be the number, but
I don't think there's any question about that. Yeah.
Yeah. So definitely, I mean, Title V and septic, I mean, that's very time consuming, especially in the spring and summer months, obviously, because that's more seasonal than anything. So you've got people that are needing to replace, you know, septic systems that are in failure. Perk tests. I'm not very familiar with the soils and the grounds in Hadley, but, you know, depending what the soils are like, perk tests can take anywhere from, you know, half hour to 4, 5, 6 hours. I mean, you could be on
now.
We
don't do the perk tests.
Do you hire out for those? Who does the perk test for you?
I would have to talk with our third guy, who's our septic person, and he's out on medical leave. But the Board of Health, Greg Misch, he did all of the septic Title V stuff, but he never went out and did perks or anything. Mm. Now, we do have somebody who the town pays. That's Richard Wilga, Margaret.
Yes, correct.
He goes out and he observes, I think, perk tests.
Yep.
Yeah, that's what I mean by doing the, when I say perk tests, I mean observing. Because
yeah, so we have somebody who the town pays to do that.
Okay. So that's typically a function of a Board of Health agent, inspector. Okay.
So we could, our job description, we could take that over from this person. Okay.
Yep.
Mark, absolutely. Are you taking some notes here for us, or Peter?
I am taking notes, but my question is, I don't even have any sense of volume, right? So how many have to be done every year? And if we have to justify how many hours a health inspector, say a full-time health inspector, would spend on food inspections, Title V and septic, that's where I have no clue.
Well, we could ask Richard Wilga how many hours he's gotten paid for over the last 12 months.
Right.
Whoever our budget person is could tell us that number.
Yeah, and you should be able to look up how many perk tests you've done last year and the year before. And it's going to be different every year, just simply because there's no real way to predict when someone's septic system is going to fail. Also, new construction, when someone is building a new home, perk tests need to be witnessed. And then along with that, not only is the agent, and I interchange agent, health inspector,
right.
It's the same person. But not only is the perk test part of witnessing the perk test part of that function, but then there's the plan review. So when the plan comes in, they have to review the plan and they have to issue the permit for the plan. Then the follow-up from there is going to perform the inspection of the system that's been installed before it's backfilled.
Right. So we have
parts to that.
Greg on our board is the one who was reviewing the plans and approving he was the one who was in charge of that. And then this same guy who did the perk test, he's the one who goes out and watches to make sure that the work's been done correctly.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Yep.
If we could get a sense of how many hours he billed for in the last 12 months, that would give us a sense of how many hours that we might need moving forward. Adding in that Greg does the, adding in time for review of the plans.
Yep.
Okay.
Another question which has come up has been the fact that you've probably seen this in the newspaper. Greenlee's had a lot of broken pipes. 40 units were evacuated in one building, 25 families, I think, from another building, and they're trying to.
Right. So we're moving on here. We're moving on here to housing issues.
Yeah. Housing.
So, people are saying, well, the Board of Health has to do something, but we don't have any inspector. So, I have no idea.
Tell us, Nicole, what the functions are.
Right.
So, in terms of housing goes, in a situation like the Greenlee's, if you did have an inspector, your inspector would have been called to that site by your emergency, responders. Right. They would have officially condemned those units that were affected by this flooding and the event that occurred. Your inspector would have cited Greenlee's ownership for the violations. So there would be written paperwork, and there would be a timeline that the Greenlee's would have to get those units and get those repairs made by. And so if there was failure to comply, the Board of Health and the inspector would have an opportunity to follow up If for some reason Greenleaf's ownership was not doing anything in terms of making those repairs or providing housing for those people that have been displaced, you know, you would take them to court. You would hold their feet to the fire. So that would be a role that the health agent, Board of Health, would take on in that kind of situation.
Nicole, when we get calls, like somebody calls and says they're renting and that their property is infested with rats or something like that.
Yep, that absolutely falls under the sanitation code, which quote unquote we call the housing code. That is a function of the Board of Health. The health agent would need to respond to that. They would schedule a time to go out and inspect the premises of the complaining party. They would observe any violations. They would write up what we call an order to correct. That order to correct would be issued to the owner of the property. In that order to correct, the violations would be cited. A timeline would be given for repair of those violations. A reinspection would have to occur. If the owner did not correct those violations by the reinspection, then you know there would be follow-up that would need to occur from there. Yep, okay. But that is the sanitation code, housing code. Yep.
And is there anything else that we're missing here? I mean, we're thinking about the food. We're thinking about the Title V and septic.
A big one is just general nuisance. Just anything that could be considered a nuisance in general. Noise, air pollution, dust, trash, odors, you know, those kind of things. Those all kind of fall under the, you know, Board of Health, local public health umbrella as well.
What do you mean by noise?
What's up?
What do you mean by noise?
Oh boy. I mean, there's a lot of directions that could go in.
Yeah, if you're making a lot of noise or there's been an issue on Middle Street with the people who are doing the, you know, the stuff for the beer, you know, there's a lot of, we've gotten calls from people, for farmers who are pumping water out of the river and that there's a right to farm in Hadley, but there's also noise, you know, certain decibel levels they have to, so all of these things require knowing the rules and following up and investigating.
So it's not someone playing their music loudly.
Usually that just falls under like a general complaint to the police department.
And right. So, but you're talking about something quite different.
I'm talking about, you know, different, more complicated noise pollution kind of situations.
Right. Yep. Which we have had calls on in town.
Yeah. And they can get very, very complicated as well. And they can go on for a very long time. And
yes.
So, you know, again, that's hard to quantify. Okay. You know.
Yeah. And a lot of it is, I mean, a lot of it is definitely hard to quantify. And that's, you know, that's the way public health rolls, unfortunately.
You know, I've been thinking that we need a full-time health agent.
Mm-hmm. I think Hadley needs a full-time agent. I thought Hadley needed a full-time agent when I was in Greenfield.
So how do you suggest we, you know, we have to justify, mm-hmm. you know, the hours needed. And that's what we keep bumping up against.
Yeah. I think definitely charts, getting all your food establishments, hours, that kind of stuff. You know, I think also, you know, you've got other departments that are within town hall and stuff that are being affected without a health agent and being pulled into public health, you know, Board of Health stuff. You know, you've got that you can sort of use as, you know, some ammunition maybe. I think that I'm going to send you guys a couple of links to some resources as well. I think that your HR department should be familiar with what they call, what the state calls, and again, I have to look up the formal name, but it's called the benchmark study. And what the benchmark study does is it takes all the communities in Massachusetts and it kind of outlines, this is their population, this is their budget, this is what their staffing looks like. I think what would be helpful for Hadley is to look at other towns that are sort of comparable in terms of size and population and food establishment wise in terms of, you know, what you have going on in town.
I see the bugaboo with that is that while we have 5,000 people here, we have that Route 9 corridor.
Correct. But, and so what you can, it can, you, and you can work around that because that I did, I was able to do that in Greenfield because I was up against a similar situation in Greenfield when I was fighting so hard to get a public health nurse. And because Greenfield for so long didn't have a public health nurse. And we had all these towns that had a public health nurse and Greenfield didn't. And I had to find a way to justify, you know, to city council and the mayor, you know, why it was so important that we needed to have one. And I was able to take that benchmark study. And even though, you know, it was hard with some of the towns because they, yes, they're similar in size, but they didn't have everything that Greenfield has. I was able to do it in that way because of that reason, because I was able to say, okay, this is a town that's similar in size to Greenfield. They don't have everything that we have, but they have a public health nurse. So how can that be? How can this town have the same population? We have X amount of this. They have a public health nurse and we don't. So I think you could actually use it to your advantage in that way to say, you know, this town has X amount of people similar to Hadley. They have a full-time health agent. They have half of the food establishments that we have. So you have to look at it in that kind of way where you're almost twisting it to say they have something that we don't, but we have twice as much as them. How can that be? Like that's how you would justify it.
And that's called the benchmark study?
Yeah, it's called the benchmark study. Your HR department is provided this study every single year by the Mass Municipal Association, the MMA. And so they conduct this study on a yearly basis. They provide all the information to, you know, the town administrators and your HR department. So
our HR department, as you probably know, we don't have an HR director.
Oh, I did not know that. I was not aware of that.
Well, we had one, but he left. I mean, he was probably in the position maybe a year. Mm-hmm. And so we have a temp from Amherst, actually. Great woman. Deb Radway has stepped in to do to help us out. But we don't.
Just leave it.
Yeah. Well, I have to tell you, you know, if you had the HR person before, I mean, these books, these benchmark studies, I mean, they've been coming out for years and years and years. They've been published for decades. And so
I should be able to find this online myself.
You could, absolutely. Yeah. And if you go to the MMA website, they may even have like a tab on their website for like the benchmark study.
I'll check that out.
Yeah.
Margaret, I mean, you know, to save yourself some time, what you might do is just shoot an email to Deb. And because I'm sure she's familiar with it. I mean, she's been in municipal HR for a number of years. So I'm sure if this is commonplace stuff, it Deb's going to know exactly what the benchmark document is all about. She'll have it.
Yeah. A lot of towns use it to do salary comparison and salary studies. And we need to be on the same level as this town. We need to raise our salaries. And so a lot of towns use it for those kind of things as well.
Right.
Yep.
You know, given the number of food establishments and the number of businesses and, you know, I'm not sure how many rentals we actually have here in town. But, you know, I know that this the sanitary housing stuff overlaps with some of the building stuff.
Mm-hmm. It does. Yep.
But it seems to me that we would have plenty of justification if we can quantify the hours. And you know, as we've said to you, that's where we're running up against stuff. I can see about trying to break down what I have here for, you know, the food stuff and how many hours that might take. Mm-hmm. And then I'm thinking, then there's just other stuff that happens in the office that I wouldn't know about, but the phone's going to be ringing and there's going to be an issue that pops up.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. You know, the other thing that I'm happy to do is send you a list of stuff that we didn't cover today that you can add to that justification list, because there is other things that I'm just not thinking of off the top of my head that an inspector absolutely would be doing in Hadley for sure. So, and listen, I mean, and that's just like the bare minimum mandates and requirements. And I mean, you've got a lot of towns that are doing more than that. And then more than that, I mean, sort of, you know, different kinds of programs for public health.
We're not even going there.
That's... Gotcha. Okay. Okay.
We don't, we're scrambling just to do the basics without anyone for us and trying to.
Nicole, you are incredible. You have been so, I don't even know how to thank you. You've been so
No, I mean, I'm like a resident now, so I'm happy to help. I mean, to be quite honest, like, I'd
like to come work with us.
I mean, I'm in over my head with my business. So I was just going to say, like, I'd love to be in a position to be able to help more. And like, I will if I can and when I can. But I am slammed. We are slammed.
I'm giving you a hard time.
I mean, I'm happy to
do you, my friend.
Yeah, no, I'm happy to join and help out when I can. You guys can email me. I'm happy to consult and answer questions. You know, it's the town I live in now. I mean, it's...
Hey, do you live on...
It's kind of outrageous that Hadley does not have a health inspector. It really is. It's kind of crazy. It's just, you know?
It's unimaginable is what it is.
Yeah, I mean, I just really... There's so many towns that have so much less than Hadley that have these services available. Yeah. And I don't know, you guys have probably heard, you know, and again, a lot of this was prior to COVID. A lot of it has taken a back seat since COVID, but you know, there's been big pushes for regionalization in local public health because, you know, staffing issues.
They're still pushing it. Yeah.
Well, and you know, I have to say, like, originally, I was not a huge fan of regionalization, but as time goes on,
I am
more and more I'm coming around to it because, you know, there's got to be, it's got to be fair across the board, you know, like the way that I see it now, you know, what's happening in
Amherst shouldn't be left up to local town government.
It shouldn't. At this point, it shouldn't. And if COVID has, you know, taught anyone anything, it's maybe this, you know. As far as mask mandates and all that stuff, you know, towns should not be left to their own accord. If there's going to be a mask mandate, it should be statewide. It shouldn't be town. Towns shouldn't be deciding this. You know, food inspections, the same food inspections that are happening in Northampton should be happening in Hadley, should be happening in Greenfield, should be happening in Boston. Everyone's food should be safe. It should be a level playing field.
Yeah.
There we are, you know.
Right.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah.
Hey, are we neighbors? Do you live on Hockenham?
So I do, but I live on like the weird Hockenham Woodlot Lane. Hockenham. Oh,
I know where that is.
Yeah. Yeah. So I guess the story was that there wasn't enough numbers to give us Hockenham numbers. And so they kind of messed up when they did the little, the four home subdivision that's in front of me. And then, you know, Steve Chimura's house. And so when they threw in the two houses where I am, there wasn't enough numbers left for Hockenham.
Well, I'm at 14 Hockenham.
Cool. Yeah. So we're Woodlot. We're the little, now we have the private lane. And so, but yeah, I should have a Hockenham number, but I'm Woodlot lane.
Yeah.
But I love it. We love it here. We love it. I love living in Hadley.
Okay.
Like I said, I was up in Shutesbury for 20 years, so I'm amongst like life now.
I can't thank you enough, Nicole. You've just, you're, thank you.
Yeah, no, you're very welcome. And like, I felt like, oh, I might be a little rusty coming in, but it just comes right back.
Yeah, this has been really helpful.
Peter, you did a really good job filling in a lot of the blanks for us.
Good, good. I'm happy to help. And like I said, I will email Margaret some additional stuff.
Thank you.
And, you know, reach out with any questions. Like, I'm happy to help as best I can. And,
great.
All right.
Thank you, Paul.
All right. You're welcome.
Thank you.
All right. Take good care, everyone. Nice to meet you.
Bye-bye. Okay. Well, that was incredibly helpful. That sort of covers the update on the budget and hiring of a temp inspector, I think, to deal with emergencies at this point. I'm not sure. You know, I think things are still very much in flux
as I see what happens.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, he put out an email several days ago to the town administrator asking if I could reach out to get a temporary inspector. I have not heard back, but I think things are just
Where do you think we should go from here as far as formulating something that documents the hours required? Peter, what do you think we should do here? What do you guys think?
So, since you asked, I think I'm on the same page as Margaret. So Margaret's referring to essentially a spreadsheet that has a list of the establishments, and they're kind of grouped or parsed out by type of establishment, you know, huge versus medium versus convenience store versus your church basement. And if we use that spreadsheet, just add another column that says a number of hours needed to perform an inspection. Okay. And then a second column that says how many inspections per year. It could be one, could be two, and just have, if you will, the spreadsheet do the math. And so, so Margaret, it sounds like you have that spreadsheet or some iteration of it.
Maybe another column that says administrative, you know, time.
Yeah. So actually the spreadsheet that I created was an alphabetical spreadsheet of all the food establishments in town that had been inspected and their dates of inspection and the number of violations. I wouldn't use that one. Instead, I received a copy of what Emma had done, but I actually not sure how I got it. Hadley Health Department inspections requested for 2020/2021, but that does group the different places. I think what I would have to do is create a spreadsheet using that data and into those sort of columns of large store and then how many.
No, remember that the convenience stores that are making food are twice a year.
Right. So
Margaret, I've got that. I've got it. Yeah, I have a version of that Jennifer did, I don't know, way before my existence at the Board of Health. Okay. So I have that. I'm using that to it kind of capture data from all these food establishments, like their email addresses, as I receive their applications for renewal and actually give them a permit number. So what I will do is I will send a copy of that to you.
Okay.
There are some columns of data that you're not going to need for this exercise, right, or that we're not going to need for this exercise. But what I can do is I can, before I send it to you, I can add a column that again says number of inspections per year required, hours expended per inspection. And then maybe, as Susan suggests, maybe a third column that says, after inspection work,
right.
Or AIW, if you will, and then let Excel do the math.
Okay, that's so fine. I'd be happy with that. Peter, is that list up to date?
Up to date, as in date, what do you mean?
Like these are the
Is it missing a lot of food vendors, Peter, or do you think it captures most of what we need?
No, so again, so this is a spreadsheet that again, Jennifer had created. I kind of borrowed it, if you will, for my own purposes for the re-permitting for 2022.
Okay.
So it's up to date in terms of permits, applications that you guys have approved over the last month or so. It has permit numbers, it has email addresses, it has phone numbers. So it's probably, I would guess, maybe 90% accurate. There's still 10% of the establishments that may not have reapplied yet.
Okay.
What I will also send to you is a list of all the permits that have been issued since I came on board in June. Okay. And what that list is, again, it's an Excel spreadsheet, and it shows the name of every business, the type of permit, and the permit number, I believe. Yeah, the permit number. So that you'll have from whatever, June 15th, whenever I started, up to January 27th. So I will send you both those documents so that you have them, so that, you know, I'm not sitting there with all this information kind of thing. So from there, that should fill in a lot of the blanks that that we had up to this point.
Peter?
Yeah.
Is there a way, can you talk to, who would know how many hours Richard Wilga has billed for over the last, for the year of 2021?
It would be Mary, the accountant.
Can you check with her?
Yeah, I made myself a note.
Because I think that will help us a lot with the septic.
The on-site observing of Title V updates or upgrades or installations, as well as the PERC tests.
And
when
you talk to Greg, you can ask him for an estimate of how many septic plans he evaluates a year.
Yeah, that's something that I don't think Wilga would know.
No, you can ask Greg when you talk.
Yeah, Greg is the only person I think that might know. Maybe with the exception of the building inspector, might know.
A guesstimate for that is fine.
I've got it on my calendar to try to reach out to Greg tomorrow.
Well, I feel like we'll be able to come up with something pretty concrete.
Yeah, it will be just a question of kind of crunching some, you know, getting this done. I mean, I'll try to do as much as I can this weekend on it.
Well, whatever you have time for, Margaret, you know.
Well, we're under the gun.
Well,
I would think that, the next step is again for me to go ahead, send you a copy of this spreadsheet that we have pretty much up to date. I'll send that to you tomorrow. Then again, it's really just kind of going back to what Nicole shared with us in terms of her best guess around the number of hours that it takes to do each task or each type of establishment. And I think that's, if you will, the second step. And then once that's done, then I think the three of us, or, you know, the two of you, however you want to do it, kind of review the numbers or the data that has been input in terms of, okay, does this make sense? Is this reasonable? Then the next step would then be to go back to Carolyn and say, okay, here's what we've come up with. We've done the research now. The numbers are not soft. They're a little harder, if you will. Where do we need to go from here? So again, so if it comes up that we need a half a body, a full body, a body and a half, the numbers will be better than I think we've been, you know, kind of kicking around up to this point.
Yep, agreed.
Right. I mean, the interesting thing that Cole also said was the general nuisance is a, quote, big one.
Right.
Hard to quantify that. And I think housing inspection, especially with the emergency stuff, very difficult to quantify.
But you can punt a little bit.
That's where the benchmark issues, the benchmark.
Right.
Whatever it was that she called them, benchmark study, will help us with that. So
right. Yeah. And Deb will definitely have that because she has old data with regards to compensation from other towns. So yeah. So she'll have the benchmark in terms of staffing as well.
Right. Okay.
Well, Margaret, that was an incredible connection you made for us.
Yeah, that's awesome.
Well, you know, I thank Tom Quinlan for that. And he was the one that floated her name. And we spoke with him the other day. He said, you know, give Dee Dee a ring. And
she's incredible.
On to her. So
right. That
part was good.
What's next on our agenda?
Let's see. Next on the agenda.
Our mask mandate.
And I think that's it.
All right. So the CDC shows that Hampshire County is in the high transmission. And I would propose that we continue the mask mandate until the transmission drops into the moderate. Once it drops into the moderate, the CDC recommends that you do not need indoor masking.
Okay. I mean, what we have gone by in the past has been the same bar, right?
Right.
Every decision we've made has been based on that,
right?
That benchmark.
Yep.
So I would say to, you know, we're trying to be consistent here, so we will go ahead. As long as it remains in the high risk category, we will continue.
All right. So you make a motion to.
All right. I make a motion that we continue the mask mandate. Do you want me to just say until such time as Hampshire County becomes a moderate risk?
On the CDC COVID tracker.
CDC COVID tracker?
Yeah. And that we'll revisit it in a month anyway.
Oh, well, then I won't even bother. But all right, until Hampshire.
But we revisit it. Because I think that better.
Okay, so we revisit in 1 month.
All right, I second the motion. Vote, Margaret?
Yes, Mastrangelo, yes.
Yes, okay, the indoor mask mandate in public places is continued, and we will revisit it in 4 weeks.
Okay, so let me just double check the agenda. We did the permit renewals. We dealt with the issue of temporary inspector, rapid testing, update on Title V issues, update on CAP, water testing, review of mask and adjournment. That's it.
And our next meeting is set for February 17th. That's
17th, correct.
February 17th. Okay.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you.